everybody. Welcome on this wonderful, wonderful day that the Lord's given us. And are you ready to make a joyful noise to the Lord? Because he's listening. Let's open in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, on this blessed day you gave us, thank you that we were able to come, that we can worship you, Lord, freely worship you from our hearts and the message you've given the pastor. We want to ask you also, Lord, that be with Natalie as she's flying to Belize. Keep her safe there, Lord. That is a place to watch out. We know your hand will be on her in that flight today and the flight home. Be with all of us now, Lord, as we give you praise and open our hearts to the message you've given the pastor for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. If you can stand, please stand. We have our doxology.
Always by my side.
next to you, let my words be few.
You are God in heaven, and here I am on earth. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so
I worship you.
Faith is the victory. We can all have that faith.
Encamped along the hills of light, ye Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the falling veils below, let all the strength be heard. It is the victory. Oh,
overcome everything with faith through Jesus. Pastor.
Good morning, everybody. Go ahead and take a seat. It's great to be here today. Not only has God blessed us with a great day, but he's also blessed us with the presence of our family so we can worship together. If you will, please join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this time that you have given to us, Lord, and this time that we can come together as your children to look into your word and to learn and grow from your knowledge. And Lord, we lift up Phil today, who received the word that his brother, his twin brother, this morning passed. We lift him up in prayer, Lord. We ask that you send a hand of comfort to him. We ask that you just let him know that he is not alone in this situation, that he does have support from friends and family. Lord, we just thank you for all the blessings that you've bestowed upon us, and we ask that you're with us now as we look into your word, that you guide us in the knowledge that we need to learn so that we can become more like you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So it used to be said, in polite society, there were two things for sure you didn't talk about: politics and religion. Today, that's changed. It seems as though in society, you can't get away from politics if you could save your life. But religion has now become taboo. It is a dirty word because of the fact that everyone wears their, well, I don't know. I want to put this nicely because I don't want to offend anyone. But it seems as though they wear their emotions on the outside instead of on the in, and they're easily offended by what's said. Unfortunately, the society we live in seems to have a great disdain for the Word of God. Everything that God says is offensive to them. So what are we as Christians to do? Do we avoid the conflict? Do we avoid speaking about God, all for the sake of not upsetting people? Or are we supposed to be bold in our witness? Are we supposed to take hold of the Word of God and proudly proclaim Jesus Christ as our Savior and our Lord? That is what we are supposed to do, regardless of what it is that society says is acceptable. They would rather argue politics then hear about free salvation. There's something wrong with that. I was speaking to someone recently, and we were having a great conversation, and you're going to find out. There's a great TV show that I watch that says everybody lies. It's the way that this man just looks at the world. Everybody lies. What I found is if you stand there and you ask somebody, are you saved? Most of the time, even if they're not, and I'm guilty of this because I did it, when somebody asked me if I was saved, I would say, yep. And they would go, okay. And they would go on. The thing is that people will say they're saved, even though they're not, just to avoid the conversation that may make them uncomfortable. And I happened to be talking to somebody that was seemingly on the same page with me with everything that we were talking about. He said he was saved. He said that he believed that Jesus Christ was our Lord and Savior. And as we continued our conversation, he made a statement that caused me to pause. And I said, wait a minute, what? The statement that he made was that I believe Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, and I believe that I'm saved. I hope that I could keep that salvation by being good. And I said, excuse me. And I didn't want to argue, but in that moment, I started to withdraw from the conversation a little bit, and I wanted to look and see if I could figure out in my head where we were going off the rails, where it was that our conversation, which seemed to be lining up, went wrong. And so I stood there for a moment, and I looked at him, and I said, you know, I have this really big urge to want to witness to you right now, because the Bible doesn't say that we have to do good works in order to be saved. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that is all you have to do to be saved. And once you are saved, that is it. No man can pluck you from God's hand. And he looked at me and he says, that's not what I learned. And I said, well, okay. Where did you learn this? And he says, well, it's kind of a long story. You see, my grandpa was a Baptist, but my mom was a Christian, and she went to this non-denominational church. And then my grandma, she called herself a Catholic. And then there was my Pentecostal aunt. And I says, and all these people gave you the impression that you had to be a good person on top of accepting Jesus. And he says, absolutely. All of them, except for one, said that I had to do more. They all told him it was Jesus plus. It was faith plus. Plus good work. And I said, no, that's not how it is. And I said, what church do you go to? Now, I've said in the past, I love asking people that because I put them on the spot. I said, but you know you're saved. What? I believe so. I hope so. I said, but you don't know so. I said, well, if you'd like, I'd love to invite you to church. I said, even if you can't stand the sound of my voice, you might get something out of it. And he says, I'll think about it. The thing is that in this conversation, in this interaction, I realized that even Christians have a hard time communicating with other Christians. Now, I understand that there's denominations that want to hold to their doctrine, and they say, oh, I don't talk to that church over there because their doctrine doesn't line up perfectly with mine. But if they believe that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, if they are true followers of Christ, it shouldn't matter what man-made doctrines they have. We should still be fellowshipping with them. We should be still cooperating with them. And that's important, that as Christians, we identify the difference between being followers of Christ and being followers of a church. We're not to be followers of a church. We are to be followers of Christ. We are to listen to what God says, not what men say. So when we do this, when we look into the fact that Christians can once in a while, now it's common, Brother Dan can read a word, and I can read a word, and our interpretation of that word might be different. Our understanding of that word may be different. The thing is that it shouldn't cause Brother Dan and I to argue and to fight. We should be working together to find out what it truly is that that word means. There was a time, and this is where it gets really dicey. There was a time when church leaders, didn't want common people to have the Bible. They didn't want common people to read the Bible because, according to them, common people didn't have the knowledge or the understanding to read the Bible and get something out of it or get the correct thing out of it. Most of the time, what it was they were doing is they were making sure that they had control of what people understood and believed the Bible to say. Even today, that is still going on, where leaderships of certain churches will tell you, do not interpret the Bible as part of what you believe, but listen to what we tell you it means. The one thing that I was taught when I first became saved was, read your Bible. If you have questions, ask them. Ask somebody that knows. Ask a pastor. Ask a deacon. Ask somebody who's been saved longer than you if they understand it. That is what we are meant to do. Unfortunately, I have to admit that to a point, these leaders that wanted to keep the Bible from us, they had a good concern. They had a valid concern. And the only reason I say this is because right now, today, there are pastors that are in the pulpits that are not preaching the Word of God. They're preaching their interpretation of the Bible. They, instead of taking God's word and preaching it and saying it word for word, they will take it out of context, they will twist it around, and they will make it about what they think it means, what they want it to mean, instead of what it truly says. So in that instance, yes, they were worried for the right reason, because out of misunderstanding comes twisted doctrine. And that is something that we have to be mindful for. That is why anyone who is sitting in a church, who is listening to a pastor, I encourage them, take notes. Write down passages. And then if you're not sure whether or not the pastor has said something that's biblical, go back and read it in context. Go back and double check him. If you double check me, I want you to. Because you know what? I'm fallible. I'm human. Which means that once in a while, I do make mistakes. The difference is that unlike most pastors who put on, admit when I'm wrong. There's a disconnect between fellow Christians and their understanding with the Bible. And when things break down and arguments ensue, we have to take a step back and we have to start thinking about what's truly important, being right in our own eyes or being right in God's eyes. Should always be right in God's eyes. Now, one word that I've come across that people seem to either not or they have a different understanding than others is the word justified. I want a quick show of hands. How many of you feel that you are justified in God's eyes? Quick show of hands. Okay. How many of you don't feel that you're justified in God's eyes? And how many of you are not sure whether or not you're justified in God's eyes or not? Okay. Anyone who raised their hand there are very brave because you're honest. And I love that. My hope is that at the end of this sermon, you will be able to raise your hand and truly know that you are justified. And here's the reason why. I'm going to go into God's word and explain what it means to be justified. The definition of justified or justification when it pertains to the Bible is the remission of sin and absolution from guilt and punishment. It's the act of free grace which God gives us as a pardon. We as sinners accept his righteousness, and the only way that we are justified is through the atonement of Jesus Christ. You might think, well, that sounds a lot like salvation to me. Right track. Because the thing is that justification is the forgiveness that God gives us, the clearing of all of our guilt and our deserved penalty for committing sin. That is God's act towards us. That is our justification, which can only be obtained through Jesus Christ. It somebody to help us, right? Jesus said he would give us the Holy Spirit to come and dwell inside us, to work within us, leading us to overcome sin before we commit it, which means that the Holy Spirit working within us is going to say, don't do it. Don't do what you use. Our salvation, Because we are justified in God's eyes, the result God's word, the more that you live in God's will, the more that you see the fruit of the Spirit grow within you, and you will be able to use your gifts that God has given you to further God's will. All of this can only be achieved through the grace of God and our faith in Jesus Christ. As I get started today, I'm going to be reading three times Romans. I'll give you time to turn there if you'd like. They'll also be on the screen. If you just want to listen, you don't want to read, feel free to do so. Romans 4. By the law. Until upon all them that come of the glory of Christ. Having knowledge of the laws will not justify you in God's eyes. Instead, what we know is the laws cannot lead you to salvation, cannot give you salvation. Only Jesus Christ can do that. That doesn't mean that we forget the laws, that we say they're not worth anything, because we could still identify our sin through the laws. And it's important that we always try to be conscious of our sins so that we can avoid them. Now in verse 24, it makes it clear that justification in God's eyes, the forgiveness of our sins, and the release from guilt and punishment, our redemption comes through the sacrifice of Jesus. Next, we're going to turn to Romans 4. We'll be reading verses 4 and 5. Romans 4, 4 and 5. Romans 4:4 says, "Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness." Now, some people might scratch their head at that. I know I did when I first read it. What Paul is saying is he's showing the difference between being made right in God's eyes by works as opposed to by faith. What he's saying is if we could justify ourselves in God's eyes by doing works, then that means we'd earn our way to heaven. Now, if you want to put that in the context that everybody understands, think about it like this. When you go to work and you do a job, you earn a paycheck. Your boss owes you a paycheck. The company you work for owes you a paycheck. What Paul is saying is that if we were able to earn justification, then God would owe us our grace. God would owe us a debt. We know that's not true. That's not possible. We know it's not possible to earn our grace. What Paul is saying is God knows that he shouldn't wait for us to become godly or righteous, because on our own we can't do it through works. So what he does is he gives us a way to welcome us into his family without earning it. And that is exactly what each and every person who is saved has done. We are welcomed into God's family without earning it. Because we are told what? We all fall short of the glory of God. It's because our faith in righteousness of Jesus Christ, God justifies us despite our sinful behaviors. There is no greater gift than that. There's no greater gift than giving somebody who doesn't deserve it a reprieve. We have no righteousness of our own. And Paul made the point when he said, "As it is written, there is none that are righteous, not one." Not one of us can ever claim to be righteous without the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Romans 4:5 says that I am ungodly. The only way God could look upon us and use us or see us as being righteous is by considering Christ's righteousness as belonging to us. Somebody said a very fitting, up-to-date version of that. You see, when you're saved, God looks at us through Jesus' filter. Instead of looking at us as sinners that we are, he looks at us and sees the righteousness of Christ. He doesn't see the sinner that we are. And when he sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ as belonging to us, he justifies us, the ungodly, and he forgives us of our sins, and he declares us righteous. Now we're going to turn to Romans 5:1. Romans 5:1, he doesn't mince words here. It's very clear. So Romans 5:1, it says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." It cannot be more clear than that. Only through Jesus Christ can we obtain justification. Only through Jesus Christ can we obtain our salvation. When Adam sinned in the garden, that sin was imputed to us. Now, imputed meaning it was transferred to us. You may hear some people say that when we're born, we are born with original sin. We're born into a sinful world. So even though it sounds unfair that Adam sinned and we got the repercussions of it. The good news is, even though God the Father viewed Adam's sin belonging to us, when Christ suffered and died for our sins, our sin was imputed to Christ. He paid the penalty for our sins. He died on the cross and paid our debt to God. Whether we want to argue that it was fair or not that we received it because of what Adam did, it was still ours. And Christ took it for us. It's through justification that we see Christ's righteousness being imputed to us. It is shared with us. And therefore, God looks at it as being ours. It's not our own righteousness, because we cannot say that we are righteous, not one of us. So it's not our righteousness, but Christ's righteousness that is freely credited to us by God. In the book of Job, I haven't brought up Job in a while. In the book of Job, there was one of Job's great, wonderful, encouraging friends, Bildad, who asked a question thousands of years ago. And that question is still a source of arguing. The question that he asked was, how can a man born of a woman be justified with God? Now, like I said, that one question, which most people gloss over, is still something that we argue about today. As I said, the gentleman I was talking to, the influences he had in his life, some of them actually said that you could lose your justification, that you could lose your salvation. There's a phrase that followers of Christ should learn. And it's sola fide, or fide. Or translated, it's by faith alone. The doctrine of sola fide asserts that God's pardon for us, the guilty sinners, is granted to and received through faith in Jesus Christ, excluding all works, meaning that it's just our faith, not faith plus works, not faith plus communion, not faith plus baptism, but just faith. Now, Catholics, Lutherans, Methodists, the ones that I mentioned earlier when I was speaking to that, you know, that man, young man actually, I call him that because he's about 10 years younger than me, so he's a young man. The Catholics, the Lutherans, and the Methodists reject this idea. They not only believe that justification is an ongoing thing that requires you to do good works, to be good, but they also believe that it can be lost. And as I said earlier, if you think about this for a moment, just speaking on justification is that forgiveness that God gives us, and it's through that justification and that forgiveness that we have our salvation, and it's that salvation that causes us to be sanctified. Now we know that if without the justification, because according to them, they can lose. So by their own beliefs, if they do something wrong, if they misstep, if they walk away from the Lord, which we know we could walk away from the Lord will never walk away from us. He's never going to leave us. But they believe that if you lose your justification, you can lose your salvation. It's wrong. Once saved, always saved. They're preaching faith plus. Now you might say, well, who's right? Are the Baptists right? The Baptists believe what we believe in, sola fide. So is that the Baptists right? Well, okay. What about the Catholics? Are they right? You know, they claim to be the oldest church in the world, and they seem to think that their rites and rituals explain everything. Are they right? What about the Lutherans and Methodists? They think that they're always right as well. So who's right? It's my belief that there is only one source that is right, and that is God. God is right. The Bible is right. Doesn't matter what we have in our creed as churches. Doesn't matter what we have as our mottos for churches, because it seems like now churches are creating taglines to try and bring people in. Doesn't matter all that stuff. Really doesn't. The only thing that matters is what the Bible says. And the Bible says a man can be justified before God. How? We read it. What matters is this. Man has sinned, and God has been sinned against. It is God who gets to dictate the terms of our reconciliation. We, as sinners, men, have no right to dictate our own terms. We can't say, oh, well, God says it's through faith, but we think it's faith and acts. God didn't say that. Well, I think it's, you know, this, or I think it's, no. What does God say? Man has no right to dictate. The sinner has no right to say how they're going to be saved. When I was growing up, as a small boy, I spent a lot of time at my grandparents' house. I used to talk about Bert quite a bit in other sermons. Not all of it was a good example. But when I would do something wrong, my grandmother would look at me and go, now, Jimmy, if you do that again, I'm going to make you go get a switch off the pussy willow. And sure enough, me being a dumb kid, I'd do it wrong again. I would do the same thing she just told me not to do. And so she would grab me and she'd bring me into the kitchen. She'd say, look. Actually, what she'd say is, look at here. But she would say, I told you not to do that. Why did you do it? She wanted to know why. Really didn't matter, though, because she had already told me what the repercussions were going to be. So I wasn't quite sure why she asked me, but she asked me. And then I told her why. And she says, well, you know what your punishment is? Go out there and grab a switch. And I would say, but Grandma, I could just go stand in the corner. That's punishment enough. Of course, in my mind, I'm thinking, that's punishment. I'm looking at the corner, but I get to listen to Bonanza that Grandpa's watching in the next room. So that's not much punishment. But that's what men do. We look at the Word of God, and we try and find loopholes. We try and justify our actions, or we try and dictate what kind of repercussions we're going to have. We change what God says because it doesn't quite fit our plans, does it? It's a little scary to think that God's going to punish us. So we try and change that punishment. We try and change or lighten the situation. Now, to continue the story a little bit, because I know you guys love these stories, to continue the story and to illustrate justification. Here's what would happen. After Grandma would tell me to go get that switch, I'd be dragging my feet and I'd be walking through the living room. And I'd stop to tie my shoes, even though I had Velcro shoes. And I'd be moaning and groaning as I was going out. And Grandpa would finally go, okay, what is it? Well, Grandma said I had to go get a switch. Now, he knew if I'd gotten to that point, I did something wrong. So Grandpa would hear me tell my story as I'm slowly walking. And then he'd get to the point where he'd hear the end of the story and where I'm now in trouble. And he'd say, hold on a second. And he'd call for my grandmother. He'd say, Isabel, come here. My grandma would come out. And he says, I'm the one that did it. I told him he could do it. It wasn't his fault. I'll take the blame. My grandmother would give him an earful because more than likely, what I did, and I can remember a few, but I'm not going to go into details, but what I was doing was detrimental to my health. It wasn't exactly the smartest thing a kid should be doing. It wasn't like I was, you know, throwing rocks at a fan or anything, but what I could do could be harmful. And isn't it fitting that Grandma, being a mother, she was just watching out and doing her job, making sure that I didn't hurt myself, and here's Grandpa. And he stops me from getting in trouble. He takes the blame. Now, because he took the blame, he also took the punishment. Because he didn't want to hear Grandma complain and yell and scream. Now, not that she raised her voice, but you could always tell she had that tone when she was mad. And she would always be very short with his name. It was Bert. And you're almost not sure what she was saying. But he knew he was in trouble. And I was grateful, but I stood there and I watched him get his ear full. And then, when my grandmother was done, she would go ahead and say, "Okay, I guess you can go play." And I would go outside and I'd play. My grandfather didn't have to take the responsibility of my actions. He didn't have to take the punishment for me, but he did, because he loved me. It's the same thing that Jesus did for us. He stepped in the gap, and he took our punishment that was rightfully ours. That is justification, because my grandfather did nothing wrong, but he took my punishment, and him not doing anything wrong was given to me. I was justified by his punishment that he took. Across the country right now, worldly minds, some of them which are in control of churches, will say, "I don't believe a just God would send anybody to hell." They say things like, "I don't believe that a just God would want anybody to die from capital punishment." They would say, "I don't believe God would do anything to punish people." They say, I don't believe. I think it's fitting that they say they don't believe. You have no right to believe anything except for what God says. That is what we should be believing. God says you may be justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. Do you have to join a church? No. God didn't say that you did. Being justified freely by his grace. Do you have to turn over a new leaf and walk the straight and narrow? No. Being justified freely by his grace. Do you have to be baptized or take sacrament in order to be justified in God's eyes? No. Do you have to be perfect in everything you do? No. Justification comes entirely by God's grace through our faith in Jesus Christ. When we read Romans 5:1, where it says we are justified by faith, you must understand there's nothing special and nothing inherently good about our faith that merits us special treatment with God. There's nothing special about our faith. No one person's faith is better than another or more valuable than another. What we learn is that in exercising our faith and showing our faith in Christ, we are essentially saying to God this: we know we cannot do for ourselves what is necessary to save ourselves, to escape the punishment that comes because of our sin. We need you. And finally, I want to read to you Titus 3:7. Titus 3:7 says that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Being justified by his grace is not, "I think or I hope that I'm saved." It's the assurance that being justified by his grace, we are made heirs to eternal life. Like I said, many people might think that you must earn God's favor for salvation, and they hope they can go to heaven. Because my salvation is not determined by me, and it doesn't depend on me, I've placed all my hope for salvation on the righteousness of Jesus Christ, as we all should. I have genuine confidence in God. that he will do what he says he will do, that he can do what he says he will do. We don't need lambs to sacrifice. God's lamb has already come. Anyone can be saved who will look at the lamb on the cross and say, Jesus, I know you died for me, and I know you took my sins and paid for them, and I trust you as my Lord and Savior. I'm going to ask Brother Bill to come up. As he is, I'm going to ask you something. I asked you earlier to raise your hands. You don't have to do it now. But are you confident that God has declared you justified? And that not only are you justified through your faith now, but you are justified in his sight forever? If you're not sure if you've been justified in God's eyes and completely forgiven for all your sins and declared to be righteous by God, what's keeping you from receiving that today? This morning, I want to encourage you to quit trusting being a good person. Quit trusting what other denominations, what denominations say. Quit trusting rituals and quit trusting sacraments or baptism. All you have to do is trust in your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Choose now to be the time that you say, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, and in his presence daily live. I want to thank you all for being here today. Brother Bill, can you close us in prayer?
Give us that blessed assurance that the pastor just spoke of. Let us pray. Gracious Father God, you came and you offered a blessing to us, to live eternally with you in peace. Just open the hearts of those, Lord, that heard this message and are still wondering how could. Well, because you came and you provided. And if we reject that, we have to pay the consequence. Be with us now, Lord, as we go forth from this place and into our daily lives. Be with us as we just travel. Give us peace. Give us safety. And we all return next week to praise you here in this place. But help us to praise you all week, Lord, for everything you do for us. In Jesus' name, amen.